good thing. If you notice, I did not put the scripture up on the thing, and that was an oversight on my part. I thought about it as I was riding up the road this morning. I says, but I didn't put the scripture on there. Boy, I can show it up on the front part. But if you've got your Bibles or your mobile device or whatever way you look at the Bible, we're in Isaiah chapter 53. And if you, in the front of my Bible, it is kind of interesting. It gives a prelude, sort of an overview of this chapter or this book. And it says that Isaiah is known as the whole Bible in one book. In other words, in the contents of Isaiah sort of gives you the whole gospel in its truth. You know, the first part of it talks about the sin of how the people have desperately fallen away from the teaching of God. And then it begins to teach later about the grace of God. Matter of fact, Isaiah is quoted more in the New Testament than any other Old Testament book. And so that is good. Isaiah was living, and his ministry was during the time of about 740 BC to 680 BC. And so he spent that time in several different leaders and kings of the southern kingdom during that time. And if you will bear with me as we, I think I'm going to read this and then we'll probably hit these verses again as we go through them. But it's Isaiah chapter 53. And follow along with me in your Bible or your mobile device as you can. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form or comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and he hid, as it were, our faces from him. And he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our grief and carried our sorrows, yet we did not esteem him. We did esteem him stricken and smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, and we have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, and yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before the shears is dumb, he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, and shall prolong his days. And the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear the iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sins of many and made intercession for the transgressions. Wow. You know, when I was looking at this text and studying for this message, I realized that I had preached part of this at times past, but I had never taken the whole chapter and preached it in context. So we're going to have to hang on and go fast through this. But it begins in that first verse. It says, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? You know, to whom is this? You know, whom has revealed, believed the report of the prophets that done it? Even in John chapter 12, verses 37 through 38, it talks a little bit about people not recognizing Jesus for who he was. It says, but though he would had done so many miracles before them, yet they believed not on him, that the saying of Isaiah, the prophet, might be fulfilled, which he spake, Lord, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? See that direct response in the New Testament? It says that that was fulfilled in Jesus, that they did not recognize him as the Messiah. The arm of the Lord here is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Is that gospel and that power, and the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to all that will believe. And therefore, the arm of the Lord is not revealed to them whose heart is not open to receive God through Jesus Christ. Isn't that powerful to think about that? In 1 John chapter 10, in John chapter 1, verses 10 and 12, it says this: he was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Wow. That is good news. That's this gospel. As we talk about this, the gospel foretold, you know, 700 years roughly before before the time of Christ, you know, his birth, here we see that he's talking about the first things that was done. In verse 2, it's talking about, verse 2 it says, for he shall grow up before him as a tender sheep and as a root out of dry ground, and he hath no form or comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He was an ordinary looking person in appearance. You know, an extraordinary person, God incarnate on this earth. And when people saw him, all they saw is an ordinary person. I think it's awesome that God would come that way. You know, that he's not clothed in royal garments. He's not got a crown upon his head. He's not got a halo above his head like we see so often in some of them early paintings of Jesus that they've done of Jesus. It says, you know, and I think of that song, one of my songs that I like so much is Our God Reigns. And the second verse of that says, he had no stately form, he had no majesty, that we should be drawn to him. He was despised, and we took no account of him. Yet, now he reigns with the Most High. This is the God that we serve. Let me tell you about my Jesus that we talked about from the revival work. This is what Isaiah's doing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. That's what he's talking about here, that he had no stately form. That he was more mighty than any man that ever walked upon this earth, because he was fully God and fully man. In verses 3 and 4, it talks about he was despised and rejected. It says, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and he hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our grief and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken and smitten of God. You know, what a powerful thought there, to thinking that he was despised and rejected of men. In Mark chapter 15, verse 12, it says this: and when Pilate was examining Jesus before the crucifixion, he asked the people, you know, he said something about him, what would they do with Jesus? And they yelled to crucify him. And then Pilate answered and said unto them, says, what will you then that I do with him whom you call the King of the Jews? And they cried out again, crucify him. Then Pilate said unto them, what evil has he done? And they cried out more earnestly, crucify him. They were yelling to kill Jesus Christ, the very one that came to bring them life, and that life more abundantly. They were yelling to crucify him. Yes, he was rejected of men. He was wounded, bruised, and chastened, it talks about in there. Wounded has the thought in the Hebrew here of being profane or defile or to pollute or to desecrate, has that thought in it, that that was that they would defile him, that they would desecrate the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He was wounded or desecrated for our transgression, for our rebellion, that rebellious spirit that we have. He was bruised. That means in that Hebrew that is broken in pieces, crushed, or destroyed. He was destroyed. He was beaten, tied to that post, scourged with that whip, and put on that cross because of us, because of the iniquities of us. And the iniquities there means the immoral behavior that we have. You know, and when we reject God, that's the immoral behavior that is in us, that is saying that here Isaiah is pointing out that immoral behavior is why he was bruised and he was put, you know, beaten down the way he was. He was chastised or punished in our place that we may have peace. Wow. That we may have peace, he went through what he did. You know, when we start talking about, you know, we hear a lot of people talking about sharing the gospel of peace. You know, I think, you know, some often I think, well, what do they mean by that? But I believe that Isaiah's nailed it right here. That gospel of peace is the gospel that we can have peace with our Lord, that there's no more animosity between us and God. There's no more separation between us and God. That we come to him, we have peace with him, and we walk in and we look at him and we behold him and we just worship and adore him, knowing that he loves us and even loved us first. Wow, that is so powerful to me. With his stripes, we are healed. In 1 John chapter 2 and verse 2, and I'm using the Geneva Bible translation here on this, which is a little older than the King James translation. It says, And he is the reconciliation for our sins, and not ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. You know, the reason I chose that, reconciliation seems a little bit better than propitiation. You know, so it sounds a little easier for me, but the reconciliation, do you realize what he's done here? He, you know, that old gospel, Southern gospel song that he made a bridge with two timbers and three nails, you know, and the picture of that is this great big void between us and God. And his reconciliation is that he built that bridge that we may cross and get into the very presence of God and be accepted into that presence of God. It says that all mankind have gone astray and sought his or her own way. Verse 6 says, all we like sheep have gone astray, is the way it said. And we have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him, Jesus, the iniquity of us all. You know something, we have gone our own way. I kind of look in that verse, what was the original sin? You know, original sin in the Garden of Eden between Adam and Eve, it was that, you know, when Satan comes to the temple and says, you will be as God. You know what that basically means, that what she was being tempted with, that you will have control of everything that goes on in your life. Isn't that really what a lot of us struggle with on a day-by-day basis? We like to do it our way. We like to be in charge of ourselves. We like to think that we're in control of our life, that somebody is not directing it. When I was in the military, Ronnie might identify with this, especially through basic training. You could be sitting there shining your boots and somebody would come by and tell you to shine your boots. Or if you were sitting there cleaning your weapon, somebody would come by and tell you, clean that weapon. It was always somebody telling you what to do, whether you was doing it or not. We like to be in control of what we're doing and think that we are in control. But that is the very thing that original sin, that very thought, that temptation of being in that control, going our own way, being in control of ourselves. And it says that because of that, that all of that was laid upon him, that on Jesus Christ. But goes on there, it stops. It's got a big three-letter word there. It says, yet, what a big one. That's one of the big words that just ties everything together. Even though that we have thrown our own way, even though that we have been in this iniquity, even though that we are in this immoral life that we have, it says, yet the Lord hath laid on Jesus the iniquity of us all. Yet, you know, even though that we don't deserve it, even though that you and I are the least of all, we can all claim like Paul that we are the least of everyone, that our sin is great because of who we are and what we've done, because we all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Yet, God loved you enough that he would send his son. It says also, talking about that as he was taken, he opened not his mouth. It says, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before the shears is dumb, he opened not his mouth. You know, in the record of Matthew chapter 26, verse 63 says, and Jesus, when he was confronted by the high priest, it says, he held his peace. He held his peace, you know, because he was not one. He was not there to complain. You know, I think about that. If he spoke the world into existence at creation, and he did, it ain't an if there, that was more rhetorical, but he spoke things into existence. If he had opened his mouth, he could have told that high priest to disappear, and he'd be gone. That's how powerful God was. But he come through this trial. He went through this crucifixion, the scourging and the crucifixion. He went through all of that, and he did not offer one bit of anger towards them, or reconciliation, or attack upon them. In Acts 8, we read about the Ethiopian. He was reading this very section of scripture when he was doing it. It says, and it says that Philip, when he crawled up in there and saw what it was running beside of that chariot, and it says it got up in there and he heard what he was reading, and he asked him to explain that. Who is he talking about? The Ethiopian said. And Philip began with that very same scripture and preached Jesus Christ to him. Wow! He preached Jesus Christ. You know, we look at this scripture and we think, well, Isaiah was prophesying this in the future. But here it opened the door that this Ethiopian would come to a body of water and say, what hinders me from being saved or being baptized? And Philip says, if you believe, you can be baptized. And they stop the chariot and in the water they go. They go down. And when he comes out, Philip is gone, but is taken away. But you know, we see that this very scripture talking about Jesus, foretelling of the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the gospel of peace. There was a woman in D.L. Moody's day in Chicago. You got to think of, in listening to this story, think of Chicago during the time of D.L. Moody in the middle 1800s. It was a central location where there were slaughterhouses all over, because the cattle would come in and all of the sheep would, and all of the things that they would kill and package for meat. And it was going on during that time. And this lady came up and asked D.L. Moody, says, I don't understand this scripture about Jesus not opening his mouth, and as a sheep going before the shears opened not his mouth. He said, to understand that, you know, need to go to the slaughterhouse. And so she took her children and they went to the slaughterhouse, and said as they would bring those cattle up the chute to have their throats cut and the bleed to die quickly, and it says they would bellow and holler as they was going up there, but the sheep would walk quietly right up the sheep to their death. And so she began to understand that Jesus on the way to the cross was quiet, not fighting it, because he knew that this was the greatest event that was going to happen to mankind, that Jesus Christ's death on the cross would bring salvation to many. It was cast out of the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people was he stricken, it talks about in verse 8 of this text that we're reading. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, it says, who his own self bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we were healed. Wow! This is a powerful thought, that Jesus you know, that was taken out of the land of the living for us. He was stricken for us, for the people he was stricken. The gospel means good news. I mentioned that in our Sunday school class. The gospel really indeed means good news. And indeed, it is good news because Jesus bore our sins on the cross, on him. I heard one revivalist speaking one time about the gate of pearl, and says, what could be so massive that a gate could be made out of one pearl? And he says, well, you know, a pearl is made because that little grain of sand gets in that oyster and it irritates it. It brings, secretes this fluid around it to protect the oyster from inside, from the irritant of that piece of sand. He says, what could be such an irritant that would cause a pearl to be so big that it could make a gate out of it? He said, Calvary. Calvary is that grain that was there that could do that, to do that. It says, he's made his grave among the wicked and in his death, and with the rich in his death. He died between two thieves. One of them repented, one didn't. But he died between two thieves. And then he was buried in a rich man's unused tomb. This is our Lord. This is our Lord. He fulfills prophecy. And you know, we think of these things, events happening, just being casual, but they were fulfilling prophecy that everyone be able to see that Jesus Christ is the promised Messiah of the Old Testament. Without sin, yet it pleased the Father to put him to grief. Verses 9, well, let me go up to 9a first, or 9a verse. In that tomb, but the last part of verse 9 all the way through 12 says that it pleased the Father. Let me just read that so I don't blow it. It says, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him, and he had made him to grief. Wow. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, and he shall prolong his days. And it pleased the Lord. It pleased the Lord. And shall prosper in his hand. Wow. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sins of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. It pleased the Father. Why would it please the Father? Because God's love for us. That's why it pleased the Father that Jesus would have to suffer. Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Wow. This is the God that, you know, why? Because he loves us. Why? Because Jesus' death satisfied the payment for our debt of sin that we have. It goes on to say, I go on and think about it. It says, why? Because God the Father shall see the travail of his soul and be satisfied. That he saw Jesus suffering and he was satisfied with what Jesus suffered because to save us. Now it's important. This is really important. Okay? So I want you to hear me on this real closely. It says, you know, God sent his Son into the world that all people should be saved. We've then read that in this text, that it came that they people, that the whole world could be saved on this. But in verses 11 and 12, it says that he will justify many. You hear that? Justify many. And bear the sins of many. Not all. Not all. Was it not sufficient? It was sufficient. But as many as receive him, in the Gospel of John, but as many as receive him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, John chapter 1, verse 12. Wow. You know, I just, when I read that verse and saw the several times that the word many was used and not all, it grieved me. Because it's not the will of the Father that any should perish. We know that. But that all should come to Jesus Christ. He's calling his children home and says, come, come to me. And he uses Jesus Christ and this picture of what he's gone through and what Isaiah pictures here, and we see in the New Testament of what Jesus Christ suffered. We see this, and he done it because he loves us and he calls us. But he says, it's for many, to them that will believe on him, to them that will be open. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. I am the truth. He is truth. In John 14, verse 6, Jesus goes on to say, or in John chapter 8, I'm sorry, he goes on to say, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Jesus is truth. He says, I am the way, truth, the truth, and the life. He is truth. You shall know the truth. If you know him, he will set you free. That's the good news. That's the gospel. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we no longer have to suffer eternal damnation because we have one who was punished for our sins. Do you know him today? If not, today would be a good day to start that knowledge. Today would be that day to start. And I pray that each one of us has that relationship with him. And that it is so important. Let's go to our closing hymn.